Our reading today is from James chapter 5. There's always a certainty inside a room like this that many of you not only know the passage, but you have studied it in the original languages, outlined it, exegeted it, and preached many amazing messages. And so I humbly approach a very well-known passage on prayer with hopes that we can find a little glimmer of truth and a lot of Christ. Listen carefully. These are God's very words to us. James 5 at verse 13. Is anyone among you in trouble? Let them pray. Is anyone happy? Let them sing songs of praise. Is anyone among you sick? Let them call the elders of the church to pray over them and anoint them with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well. The Lord will raise them up. If they have sinned, they will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. So, Lord, you tell us that your word is sharper than a two-edged sword, and it's able to discern what is of you and what is not of you on the inside of our very souls. And so would you come, show us the truth about ourselves, but most especially, Lord, show us the truth about who you are and why you want us to pray. In Jesus' name, amen. It was exactly last year at GA that my wife and I got on a plane early on Wednesday, and we actually flew home because our youngest granddaughter, who was 3 months old, had been diagnosed with a significant spinal problem. And the spine of a three-month-old is not very big. And so she was scheduled for emergency surgery. So we flew home to be there, and Jeff Jeremiah, as he was praying over us, and he asked you guys to pray, would you pray for this little child as they leave? And I'm very thankful for that. The amazing thing is first medicine, the surgery that she went under, what they do is they cut a hole in the bottom of her spinal cord, and then a doctor with a microscope goes in and pulls out her spine, out of the spinal cord. It's kind of like a big spring in there for a little baby. It's got to have room to grow, and there were places that were attached incorrectly. So this doctor with a microscope pulls it out of her body and then fixes it. And then, like an electrician packing wire into an old piece of conduit, he puts it back in there, sews it shut, and says, well, I think I found it all. I think she's fixed. But the truth is, we won't know, because all of these things will appear as she grows if we haven't really fixed it, and she won't be able to control her bowels or her bladder, and she certainly won't be able to walk. If we see those signs, we'll know that there's still other issues going on. So she was 3 months old exactly a year ago. She's now 15 months old. If you don't mind, may I introduce you to her? So these are my, this is Abigail. Is God good or what? So I show that to you because you prayed, and God hears our prayers. Amen?
Amen.
And I know they're spectacularly beautiful, all of them, which is almost impossible given that I am their genetic pool. but I just want to confess, I'm a mess. I really am not you know, people, don't they put us pastors up on a pedestal and they try to make us more than we really are? They try to make us think like we have great prayers, so pray for us, pastor, because that will change the world. Or elders, they think that we somehow are holier or we have a special red phone on our desk or there's something that goes on. And the reality is we don't. What we hope we have is a measure of maturity and a measure of faith and a measure of dedication to the Lord gained usually over lots of bad choices. You know, you learn good behavior from failed bad behavior. And I hope that that's true in here, that we can look back on our trail and say, you know, it's not because we're so smart or so good. When God blesses us, and God has done amazing things at this church, and I'm awed, but it isn't about me. And God is always reminding me, it isn't about you, Brad. It's kind of his personal goal to remind me that I am not that big a deal. I'm sitting in an airplane a few years ago, sitting next to a lovely brunette, and she's right as we get ready to take off, short flight from Washington, D.C. to Dallas, I think, and she's got one of those old flip phones, and this was a few years ago, and I had just gotten my iPhone 5S, you know, and at the time, it was the cat's meow, it was the thing, everybody wanted it, and so I had it out, and she said, oh, that's one of those new phones, and I said, yeah, let me show you what it does. You know, and I kind of showed her all the things that I knew, all my understanding of technology, the internet, you know. I told her I invented the internet. I didn't, but I used this phone to say, look what can I do. I can go here. Look at all the library books I've got. Look at all this stuff I connect. And she was really impressed, I thought. So after I talked for 20 minutes about how brilliant I was, especially with technology, I asked her, so what do you do? And she smiled and she handed me her card. And it said, Lieutenant Colonel so-and-so, Assistant Director, NASA. I said, wow, what do you do? She says, I'm an astronaut. And we talked about her, and I said, so I didn't really impress you all that much with my iPhone, did I? She said, no, but it was fun to listen. And once again, I am Forrest Gump. You know, duh, you know, it's a box of chocolates, I don't know. So I feel that way a lot, and even preaching this morning, I feel that way. What an amazing day we had. We have a man who God used, broke, humbled, and then restored after 2 years in prison. I don't have anything in my life to really match that story. I don't. And then Doug Webster spoke, and he's one of my mentors and one of the people who I have greatest respect for, and I was like, wow. And then Leonce. I mean, I need a stool back here. You know, I don't have his stature nor his ability to just phrase words. He has that gift. And then there's me. And honest, it's intimidating sometimes. When you're feeling bad, it's really intimidating. You feel like, Lord, I don't have anything to bring these people. I wonder if today's a good day for me to become a plumber. And you guys know that feeling, that for whatever reason you haven't had prep time or you haven't really been able to put it together or you feel like your pastor's been under stress and the messages that they bring isn't a home run, it's just kind of a long fly ball. And the reality is that we've all lived through that. And I think God wants to remind us as leaders, it isn't about us. It's really about Laysen Albatross. Laysen Albatross. I want you guys to remember this. Laysen Albatross. This is piratable. When I was in seminary, you know, the best sermon that you'd give, you'd notice all your classmates in back that we all started doing this. That's our pirate patch. We're stealing this. This is a pretty good illustration. I think you guys can borrow this. And it's okay, I give you permission. The Laysan albatross is one of the largest seabirds in the world, but it's weird looking. It has the body about the size of a chicken. It has little teeny duck legs, and then it has these amazing, amazing, amazing wings that are 7 or 8 feet long. Its wings are most of its weight. There's not much to it. It's just horribly designed. If I were talking to God, I'd say, come on. What is the deal with the Laysan albatross? And that's really clear. It lives on a couple of islands near the Midway Islands in the South Pacific. And the reason it's poorly designed is it can barely get off the ground. You see, those little legs cannot generate enough ground speed as it runs along. So it runs along flapping its wings, but the Bernoulli effect never takes place. There's never enough air moving over its wings, so it just runs up and down the beach for whole days trying to get off the ground. It's not designed to take flight. And the same is true that if it ever does get into the air, when it comes down to land, it's a hilarious sight because it's trying to come into land, and it gets those little legs moving, so they're ready. But when it hits the ground, it's like boom, 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 boom. Tumble down to beach, sand everywhere, and then it gets up, looks around, see if anybody notices. Shakes off the sand and pretends that it's all good. Just like us. Sometimes we think we have it together and we think we're bringing it in for a perfect landing and we crash and we burn a little bit. And then we look around and say, who saw? Because we get embarrassed. That's probably why they call the Laysan albatross the Goonie Bird. It doesn't really have an ability to get off the ground very well. I think this is the truth of you and I. I think this is the truth of you and I because once the Goonie Bird gets into the air, something dramatic happens. It is designed not for life on the ground, it's designed for flight. And when a Laysan albatross, a Goonie Bird, takes off, it can fly for 4 years without touching land. It swoops down into the ocean and grabs a fish, and then it goes up and soars again. The adolescents leave for years at a time and fly around the Pacific because it takes no effort. Its body is so small, its legs have so little resistance in the wind that its wings are enough, and it can ride the currents almost forever. Interesting fact about the Laysan albatross, and I know you're going to love this. It does unihemispherical sleep. You all know what that is, right? Okay, I won't explain it then. Unihemispherical sleep. That means that during those 3 years that it's flying, it sleeps one half of the brain at a time. One half stays awake, and one half goes to sleep. And then sometime one bumps the other and says, come on, it's my turn. And the sleeping side wakes up and the side that's been flying, it goes to sleep. Which, by the way, looks a lot like a lot of my elders in a session meeting. Unihemispherical sleep. They look like they're awake, but I'm pretty sure at least half of their brain is gone. So they do that. They're designed to be in the air. God has designed them so that they can sleep in the air, they can eat in the air, they can never touch land for years. It's an extraordinary thing that scientists have had to put little sensors on them to track them because they just go and they fly. And I think that's about our passage today. Our passage is really about Laysan albatross. Is any of you in trouble? Let them pray. Is anyone happy? Let them sing songs of praise. I think that James is trying to push us towards something. What I really think is he's trying to get us off the ground. He wants to get us up in the air. Do you know how it is possible that lace and albatross even can fly? The wind. If the wind never blows, they never fly. But when the wind comes up, it adds enough to the energy of their little legs that if they run right into the wind, it picks them up and it lifts them and it carries them. They're one of the few species of birds that have to take off with the wind blowing into the wind, just like an aircraft. They have to get up, and if the wind doesn't blow, they don't fly. But if the wind blows, they fly forever. I think that's what James is trying to get us to say. You guys are trying to do it on your own. In fact, he's just been talking about suffering and difficulty, warning to rich oppressors, boasting about tomorrow, patience and suffering. That's what's going on before this. And now he's getting ready to close, and he's writing to Christians who the diaspora from Jerusalem has scattered them into places of persecution, and they're starting to wonder, how do we get through this world that we live in? How do we do this? And James, in his very last chapter, says, you're going to need wind. You cannot get off the ground by yourself. Is any one of you in trouble? The word in the original language there means beset by evil or in difficult circumstances. It's a pretty broad word. Is any one of you feeling oppressed or beat down? All of that would fit. He says, so what should you do? You should pray. You should seek the wind. You seek the wind. Is anyone happy? Let them sing songs of praise. By the way, songs of praise are just another form of prayer. It's another dialogue to God. They're not separate things. They're exactly the same things. What is James saying to them? If you're sad, seek the wind. Why don't you pray? See if you can catch a breeze and get off this ground. If you're happy, tell people about it and sing. Catch the wind. See if you can get off the ground and give glory to God. He's trying to be really broad in that Hebraism or that poetry of the Jewish mindset. He's painting a picture from one end to the other. Are you in trouble? Seek the wind. Go to the Lord. See if the wind will come. Are you doing good? Go to the Lord. In between, guess what? Go to the Lord. It's all really about, will you pray all the time? Verse 14, is any one of you sick? Let them call the elders of the church to pray over them and anoint them with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well, and the Lord will raise them up. If they have sinned, they will be forgiven. I love what James is doing here. Prayers to come from those in trouble, prayers to come for those who are happy, prayers to come from those who are weak and who need help, who have to go, and prayers to come from the leaders of the church who are to pray. It's almost like James is saying, in every circumstance and in every moment, every Christian should have as our norm to seek the wind, to look for the Lord, to pray, to say, Lord, I'm struggling. Lord, what are you doing? Lord, thank you. Wherever we are, the goal of James is to say, you know how you're going to get through these difficult times ahead? Get good at turning to me. Praying without ceasing. Always turning to the Lord. It's interesting. I don't think it's just talking about sick people, because the word it uses there for sick is really most often translated in Scripture, weak. Is any one of you weak? So sickness fits into that, physical sickness, but so do so many things. My family is having a hard time getting along. I can't get my grandkids under control. I can't get my elders, Lord knows, under control. Whatever the issue is, if you're feeling weak, I don't know that I have it in me to get up and preach. Last night, I told my wife, I do not want to preach tomorrow. She said, you love to preach. I said, I know, but Leon's was so good. I'm just going to go eat worms in the garden, okay? And she's like, get over yourself. and get ready. And I think we all know that feeling. It just took a moment for me to say, Lord, it's not about me anyways. It's not about me. It's about you. To you elders, I want to say, if you are not praying for the weak in your congregation, if they don't know that they can come to you and ask for prayer, if part of your session meeting doesn't include the openness for somebody to come, would you just pray for me? You're missing some of your call. And it's not the oil. There's no magic in the methodology. Sometimes we look for, okay, so what oil and how much? And in reality, we're just dumb birds. I love this Isaiah passage, and it gives a little clarity what this whole oil thing is. It says, if your whole head is injured, your whole heart afflicted. From the sole of your foot to the top of your head, there is no soundness, only wounds and welts and open sores, not cleansed or bandaged or soothed with olive oil. He's speaking to the spiritual condition of his people in this passage. And isn't it interesting that part of this medicinal way is to bind and to bandage and to clean and to soothe with oil? I think that's really the image here. It's not probably meant in the anointing sense, but in the healing sense. It's a symbol of us being faithful, of us doing what the Lord says. If we're not doing that, we're probably not praying like the Lord wants us to. I can tell you story after story after story, like Isley, where people prayed and the Lord worked. Now, I've prayed for some people and they've gone to be with the Lord. So I don't know the right incantation. And sometimes the Lord has a plan that is different than my plan and your plan. But I have seen the elders get around and pray for people, and I have watched them get healed. And I don't know why. And in America, it's really hard because we pretty much are healed by our intellect or our MasterCards. We can figure it out, or we can pay somebody to figure it out for us. And I'm thankful for the medical system that we've got. But part of what he wants us to do is be praying for each other. So individuals, if you're in trouble, pray. If you're happy, sing songs of praise. Elders, sick, everybody get together from the weakest to the strongest. And he says, in the prayer offered in the name of, in faith will make the sick person well, the Lord will raise them up. He's bringing us back to what's the real source. It's not about us. It's not about the way we do it. It's not even about the prayers that we say. Simply about trusting the Lord and doing it and then letting his will be done. Then it moves on. So it first talks about individuals, then it talks about leadership, and now it says this: therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. It takes it to a corporate level. This is not just a few of the most mature. This is the normal condition for the body. One of the hardest things I've had to do is I've stood up here before and trying to be funny, I've said something and it's offended someone. And I'm an extrovert, which means that my mind works 1 second after my mouth. And I kind of want it back, but you can't get it back. And I've had to stand up here and say, I hurt my wife last night by telling you that silly story. And I want you all to know I've asked her to forgive me. Kathy, will you forgive me? And she says yes. And I also want you to know I'm just a man. And the best of men is a man at best. And so, and I've had people come to me and say that was one of the most powerful moments in our service. Because you were real and honest and you modeled behavior. Therefore, confess your sins one to another. I know you feel the pressure to look squeakier clean than you really are. I know you feel the pressure to be taller and smarter and to always have the right answer. I know you feel the pressure to always be right and wise and good. But you, my brothers and sisters, are goony birds. And until you own that, the Lord will give you lots of opportunities to crash and burn. And eventually you say, Lord, this isn't about us, is it? No, it's not. It's not about us. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. The word for powerful there is energeo, energy. It gives energy to who we are. It lifts us up like the wind. It energizes us. It's powerful and effective when a righteous person prays. Tell my mom, I'll call her back. But I want to make a point. It says the prayer of a righteous person. So is that me? Is that you? Well, only in Christ. The reality is that we gain no righteousness. There is no one righteous of our own. So it is only when we are in Christ. That's why praying in Jesus' name changes everything. In the name of Brad, be healed does nothing, except maybe cost me my job. But in the name of Jesus, it changes everything because the righteousness that is attributed to him comes to us. Comes to us. In 2011, a magnitude 9 earthquake struck Japan, and I'm easily distracted, ADD, and a wave rolled over the islands where the Laysan albatross lived. 110,000 birds and all of their eggs were destroyed. And naturalists thought the species will take hundreds of years to recover. But it recovered in almost 2 years. You wanna know why? There were lots of birds flying. And they came home and they took what was decimated and they started a new colony. I just love it. And there's an interesting thing that happens with the Laysan albatross. The young ones don't know which way to run to find the wind. They don't know. It's a learned skill. It's not an innate skill. And so the adults line up and make a runway so that all those who don't know which way the wind is coming from don't just run around in circles. You want a call on your life, my brothers? We need to make a runway of prayer so that the people who follow us, the youngsters, they don't flounder looking for a way to get off the ground. They know the way. If we could just make a runway so that every teenager in our churches knew how to pray to the Lord, seek his face, listen to his voice, it doesn't really matter then what happens. The Lord will guide them. And if they're connected to him, it all works out. Seek the wind. Seek the wind. Seek the wind. Stop trying to do it on your goony bird legs. And realize that God has designed us to be a people of prayer on a good day or a bad day, when we're weak or when we're strong, when we're alone or when we're in the whole body. We are designed to be a people of prayer. Seek the wind. Seek the wind. Let's pray. Our hope, Lord, is that we might become the church of prayer. Not necessarily the church that prays, but the church of prayer. That prayer becomes our regular way, that we recognize that we're designed to be in communion with you, in communication with you, that we're your sheep and your sheep know your voice and we hear you and we follow, we respond. Lord, may that be true. We ask now in the name of Jesus that you would make us a people of prayer. That it wouldn't be something that we talk about, but that you would begin to build a hunger in us to pray. That we'd have a want to pray, Lord, and that you would show us ways to pray every single moment of every single day, that we would pray. And when we notice that we're crashing and burning way too much, Lord, would you help us to find others who will give us a runway, that we might get off the ground again. We give you Great praise, Lord, for what you have done today, and we ask that you would continue to do it for your glory alone. And all God's people said, amen.